Tom here from Orange Systems. I want to do a follow-up video on the SG1100 and the SG5100. This one's pretty solid. It's passively cooled all metal there. This one's pretty light. But one of the things I like to provide value on this channel is not just like the review of the device. What does the device look like over time installed? The other thing I wanted to talk about is I almost want to call it a persistent myth, and there are exceptions to it. But the myth is that you need a really high-end piece of hardware to route traffic even at gigabit speeds. And the reality is you don't. That's not really necessary. I'm going to talk about both these devices because they're not overly powerful, but I'll talk about what they look like real-world use case installed and us using them. And I'll break down some of the, you know, over time, over the last 6 months, the processor usage as an example. But first, if you'd like to learn more about me and my company, head over to lawrencesystems.com. If you'd like to hire a short project, there's a Hire Us button right at the top. If you want to support this channel in other ways, there's affiliate links down below to get you deals and discounts on products and services we talk about on this channel, including a link to our Patreon if you'd like to become a Patreon supporter. We also have a swag store where you can get shirts and other items that are for sale, and that changes from time to time what's available and what's not, so go ahead and check that out frequently. And finally, our forums. If you'd like to have a more in-depth discussion about this video, suggestions for new videos, or just reach out, say hi, and talk tech, our forums are a great place for that. All right, now back to the content. We're going to start here with the SG1100. This has been my go-to for a lot of home users. It's really an easy turnkey box for getting started with pfSense if you don't want to mess with hardware. If you want to mess with hardware, of course, building it is always an option. But if you go, you know what, I just want to dive into learning the firewall rules or just use this to protect my home, this is such a great go-to box at only $179, which is the current price here in May of 2020. Now, the use case. I am using OpenVPN. I'm running Zabbix on here for monitoring, which we'll show in a second. Well, just a plugin on here. It doesn't use much resources in terms of the firewall itself, but it's how I get these stats that you're going to see. And I do use PF Blocker. So besides not using it for a whole home VPN, which it's capable of doing, but that is where the VPN performance is not going to be wonderful on this. But for $179, you get a low wattage, low powered box that's really adequate for most of my needs. And a lot of what we do at home is just watching YouTube, streaming services, Netflix, etc., some Zoom videos, and plenty of games. And I have had no issues at all running it for all of those services. You get the full version of pfSense, whether you're running it on this, whether you build it yourself, or whether you go to a higher-end system. So there's not really any shortcomings other than you're dealing with different processor speeds, which is why you would want faster or slower systems. But when you look at the specs on this, it's really not too bad. I mean, it's not great. Don't get me wrong. That's what makes it low powered is the fact that, well, there's just not a lot of horsepower under the hood. But for routing purposes, it's perfectly fine. My 300 meg connection at home has no problem running over this. This is a Core A53 processor at 1.2 gigahertz. Got two cores in it. It has 1 gig of DDR4 onboard RAM, 8 gig of eMMC storage, and that's about it. And with all of that running, we're still sitting here, not overutilizing it. And this is what the last 6 months of usage. Now, this is Zabbix. I use Zabbix to query my pfSense boxes to aggregate statistics on there. Specifically, this one's the CPU utilization. And it works fine. Now, this right here where you're seeing more CPU utilization, if you go back through my channel, you see a few months ago, I wanted to push it. And I said, all right, I'm going to load HAProxy and Let's Encrypt and do certificates on it. It'll handle reverse proxy and everything. It's the CPU usage probably went up to about 30-35% doing that, but it still worked. It's probably not the ideal HAProxy if you want to do something higher end, but as far as learning it, it is easy to do on this, and it is completely capable without maxing out the system able to do that. Now, it's not going to be good for Cerakata. That comes up in my previous reviews of people could say, what if I want to run all the extra security tools? That is where you're going to have some limitations in processor, and we'll get to the other one in a second on that. But for average usage, and I know my wife said she was downloading some games, so let's look in the last 3 hours of usage. It does peak up a little bit, but doesn't really seem to affect the download speed. We're still able to get the full provided by my ISP 300 megs through this box without a problem, downloading Steam games like she was or whatever it is she was downloading. I don't know. She messaged me about it. But it was no problem. The box handles it fine. And we do this all the time. We've got more than one gaming computer at home and also a Wii. All of them work perfectly fine through there. Yes, and I will mention really quick, though, if you have a Wii, look up Wii and pfSense. There is some games that require some type of one-to-one NAT rule that is a problem with the way Nintendo implemented things. It's not a pfSense problem. There is a pfSense solution for it, for those wondering about gaming. But generally, all the games that have a server that you have to get to online works perfectly fine. I've had no issues with more than one computer gaming with it. There may be some exception with some certain games, but if there's enough requests, though, leave some comments or head over to my forums and ask about that, or head over to the NetGate forums. There's a lot of discussion if you have some particular use case. But these do support, not out of the box, but can be turned on with UPnP to make some gaming work. Still recommend it for home. It's a great solution. It's just out of the box. It comes more secure by not having UPnP turned on, but you can turn it on. But it's been a great performer, like I said, and I'm really happy with it. Next one, this guy right here. Now, I do, and I'll bring it up because I got one sitting here. We do install a lot of these. I'm not doing a follow-up today on this one. This is the SG3100, and it does work really well for small businesses. We deploy quite a few of these, little small offices, law firms, dental offices, etc. It does perform really well. The VPN performance is pretty good on it, but not really what the BVM performance is when you get to the 5100. This has been a more popular one here in 2020, and we've actually ended up upgrading some clients to it because their demands when we installed something, the VPN demands in 2020 have gone up substantially. This has been kind of a go-to solution. Once again, passively cooled, like, well, all three of the devices here I mentioned and the two I'm reviewing, the 1100 and this. Passively cooled is always great because, well, one less thing to potentially cause noise or failure like a fan. Fans have pretty reliable nowadays, but it's still think about it like in the past when fans would go bad or get a little dust in them, being passively cooled solves those problems. Now, this is what we're using, and the example we're showing is what it looks like in use at our office. So let's go ahead and start with the specs of the 5100. So the 5100 firewall appliance is a Intel C3558 2.2 gigahertz with ESNi, 4 CPU cores, 4 gigs of RAM, 8 gig EMCC flash on board, and then it's got the 6 network interfaces on here. So plenty of, solid use case for business, has all the same pfSense features you get. But what does it look like running? Well, not really exciting. It's probably idling around 5 or 6% over the last 6 months. And you're probably saying, well, Tom, you must not have Suricata and all these other things running. And we're going to switch real quick. This is just a screen grab from my dashboard. We are running the Let's Encrypt. We run HA Proxy. We run PF Blocker we do country code filtering. We have a lot of filtering for things we self-host to lock them down to keep secure. We have Suricata running. We have a block of IP addresses assigned to this for all the different services we have. And there's just a lot going on. There's a lot of configuration, a lot of rules. And there's not too much going on because I'm recording this on an evening on a Saturday. So there's not as many, there's not much people logged in right now because, well, it's a Saturday. We're not doing a whole lot today. But for day-to-day usage, running all these services, no problems. It just sits here. And we'll go back real quick. And we'll look at like the last 3 hours here. I did some testing just so I could make it get loaded up by moving backups back and forth between legs of the network. And I was able to peek it out with just testing up to 80%, but it wasn't enough to actually cause any problems with it at all. So for the most part, you can see it just goes back to idling away. And when we go back over to stretching things out over 6 months of use, just not much. Now, I guess we can cover real quick memory usage. And if we look at that, it's much the same. We're just not using the green. It's kind of in reverse here. The green is the available memory. And you can see over the last 3 months, well, even over 6 months here, these little dips are when things may have been restarted or services restarted that caused it to dip, or when there was an update applied, it takes a second and will show while all the services are booting, it'll send a ping with something low and create a spike in the graph. But you can see it's really not, and actually it's pretty straightforward. It doesn't use all the memory. And this is where I've seen people go, well, do I need 16 gigs of RAM? Do I need some really high-end compute power just to run pfSense? And actually, you don't. Even with the services we're running as a business, and we usually have 3 or 4 people logged in, sometimes more on the VPN, it just doesn't really load up this system. It's kind of that myth that I think people have in their head that it needs to have a really high-end processor in order to route gigabit traffic or in order to run Suricata. Now, that does true. These are those exceptions I said. If you're running something like a extremely high-end network with thousands of endpoints and on the number of state tables and sessions it has to keep track of, along with, let's say, you have a series of servers. And data center usage comes up occasionally because we've put these in, or even like the even higher-end ones in data centers. Yeah. if you are trying to filter massive amounts of things and running HA proxy and load balancing, et cetera, you may need higher end hardware. For the most part, even in office usage with all the connections we have here, even the self-hosted systems we have here, this runs perfectly fine. And our connection here at the office is only a 250 meg connection. And as I mentioned, we have a block of IPs and we haven't really run into any issues at all. It just kind of sits there idling away, doesn't get hot. It's not being stressed at all. And it's one of the things I wanted to make sure was clear that from a follow-up standpoint, yes, this one, despite having a little bit higher CPU usage, we have no problems watching Netflix and playing games. And from a business usage, this thing is almost overkill for what we're doing, with the exception of when we do need the VPN speeds to move files in and out over the VPN. It is handy to have it, the power at your fingertips, and it's really not that expensive of a firewall. Honorable mention though, maybe we'll do another follow-up on these, but we have so many of these deployed and these are also equally good, with the minor exception of the VPN speeds being a little bit slower on this compared to the 5100. But that's my real world follow-up. Like you can see, just based on the graphs and based on the memory usage here, that it doesn't really take that much to run pfSense, even for a business. I guess the last quick thing I can follow up on is show the memory usage for the SG1100. And yeah, it's using half the RAM in it. Half the gig of RAM is used in it to be able to do that. So once again, it doesn't take a lot of memory to do all these services, even when you start using things like HA proxy. And I mentioned that in my HA proxy video that I do. If you look, it is all done on an SG1100. But if you want to buy any of these pieces of hardware, I've got no offer codes or links for you. Head over to NetGate and buy them. They're great products. We use a lot of them. If you just want to build it yourself, you can just go to pfSense and download the ISO and build it yourself. But you may not need as much hardware as you think to get things done. And you need very little hardware really to get started with it. All right. Thanks. And thank you for making it to the end of the video. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. If you'd like to see more content from the channel, hit the subscribe button and hit the bell icon if you like YouTube to notify you when new videos come out. If you'd like to hire us, head over to lawrencesystems.com, fill out our contact page, and let us know what we can help you with and what projects you'd like us to work together on. If you want to carry on the discussion, head over to forums.lawrencesystems.com, where we can carry on the discussion about this video, other videos, or other tech topics in general. Even suggestions for new videos, they're accepted right there on our forums, which are free. Also, if you'd like to help the channel out in other ways, head over to our affiliate page. We have a lot of great tech offers for you. And once again, thanks for watching and see you next time.